Christ Jesus, you paid for the cross. You went to the grave. For the grave, you went to the sky. Lord, I need you. You came from heaven down to the earth.
Open your mouth and bless the name of the Lord Jesus. Open your mouth and bless him, bless him, bless him. Father, we give you praise for the price that you have paid, for giving up your life that we might live, and resurrecting again that our lives in you might be sustained. The Lord of the heart of us, the Tokopakatuana Bahasa, the Pose Bahandebus, Zetokepande Sabatas, Mandedes, Sakosia. Lord, we bless you. Lord, we bless you. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you glory. And O Master, Azekapandesia, Zetokepos, Supra, Andedebus, Andede Hanabalabakos, Zemonana, and O Nasua, Sagabasa, and Leto Andesaita, Babes Yanabas, Indobos Yadesa, Zanedobos Yadabahades. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. I belong to my God. I am glad.
I belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. I belong to my God.
I am glad.
I belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus.
I belong
to my God.
Prayer. Lord, thank you that I belong to you. I don't belong to challenges. I don't belong to tribulations. I don't belong to affliction. I don't belong to sickness. I belong to you. I belong to you. I don't belong to lack. I don't belong to pain. I don't belong to shame. I don't belong to agony. Lord, I belong to you. I don't belong to darkness. I don't belong to hell. Lord, I belong to you. Open your mouth and bless in this morning. I belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. I belong to you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Os kapandebegebos, lendomobos siyadabahadabas, tekepros kabiyadabahadas, shetekep tekepros kabahad, ibarus tekepandesha. Bible speaking is there. With the heart we believe and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Lord, I belong only to you. I belong only to you. I am not going to be shared with anyone. Oh Lord, I totally and completely belong to you. Thank you, Father. Oh, Sabra and the Kala, Sedeke Petoski and the Bas. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. All right, for the sake of time, let's be seated this morning. I want to begin by appreciating the leadership of the church. Please, sir, you can continue. Play for me.
Thank you.
I want to appreciate the leadership of the church on behalf of our pastor,
I want to thank him even in his absence, and then also I want to thank the assistant pastor, the ministers, our zona pastor that is around. God bless you, sir, and to the entire church, your Lord. Amen and amen. All right. What do we say to our choir? You see, in this part of the world, we don't celebrate our own. If we bring Franket Lord now, you'll be running helter skelter. Yesterday, I was somewhere, I think, around this Babi Saloa. They said Burna Boy was in town yesterday, and he went to see Governor Wike. And that the crowd that came was so much that they had to follow another route. And when people heard that the guys around, he followed another path, they marched and went to government house. You see how the world celebrates their own. And in church, we have, you see, the music they did today is worthy of what being sold anywhere in the world. Hallelujah. We pray that God will take them far in Jesus' name. All right, this morning, let's go to the business of the day. Please project for us Joel chapter 1. I made a discovery recently that baffled me, and as it is my culture personally, when I'm going to be ministering like this, I don't take so much time in knowing what I'm going to deliver, because the word comes weeks before the assignment is dispensed to me personally. And so everything that have been happening here today, even down to the song they sang, was aligned with what God placed in my heart for us this morning. So I want us to be very, very conscious. Let's be attentive, shun distractions, no movement up and down for these few moments that we are going to be shewing the word of God. Hallelujah. Now, before we continue reading, there is a plague. There is an arrow fired at us. I discovered something that is worse than sin. Reading Bible, most times you see the afflictions of men, they are traceable to iniquity. Are you listening to me now? When I see somebody that is greatly afflicted, the first question you will ask is, what has he done? Right? Imagine, Bible told us that if you break the edge, what happens? So there is a repercussion. There is a due payment that happens when a man breaks an edge. I thought sin was the greatest problem of mankind, but I found something else that is greater than sin, more powerful than sin, that is very, very destructive, more than sin can be. Joel chapter 1, we will be taking a long reading until I get to where I want us to stop. Verse 1, it says, the word of the Lord that came to Joel, the son of Petuel. Verse 2, hear this, ye old men, and give ear, all ye inhabitants of the land. Have this been in your days, or even in the days of your fathers? Verse 3, tell your children of it, and let your children tell their children, and their children another generation. That which the palmer once had eaten, had left, had the locusts eaten, and that which the locusts had left, had the canker ones eaten. Next, and then there was a call. He said, awake, ye drunkard, and weep. Meaning you should call for a solemn assembly for what has happened. And hold all ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine, for it is cut off from your mouth. Next, he said, for a nation is come up upon my land, strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he had the sheep teeth of a great lion. Next. He had laid my vine waste and barked my fig tree. He had made it clean bare, and cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. Next. Lament like a virgin guarded with sackcloth of the husband of her youth. Just in case you don't understand what this is in, it's saying that, are you a youth that just got married and you lost your husband? How are you going to weep over him? He said, it is after that kind you should weep over the decadence that is taking place here. And so the next, yes, verse 9. He said, the meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests, the Lord's minister, mourn. The field is wasted. The land mourns. For the corn is wasted. The new wine is dried up. The oil languishes. What is happening? I know by now you should start asking, what did the people do? Who sinned, right? Isn't it? We should ask. We remember that there was a time that the children of Israel went to war against Ai. And Ai was a small country, a small group of people compared to the other people that they have defeated in time past. But all the time they attempted defeating them or fighting against them, they were greatly injured and defeated. Are you with me? And now the man of God, the prophet Joshua, came and said, Lord, where have we missed it? And then they said, in the camp of the Israel, someone sinned. And you know what happened to them? That resulted into what? The destruction of every one of them and their family alike. And so when I was reading with an hunger to see what the problem was. Until I saw that it is one little thing that we all have been neglecting. So what is that thing? That's why we are taking this long journey. Hallelujah. And so the next one said, what's the next one, sir? Okay, he said, be ashamed because something is missing, that you should be ashamed. Oh, ye husbandmen, hold, oh, ye vine dressers, for the wheat and for the barley, because harvest of the field is perished. He said, this thing that is missing now, because we are chasing the problem, right? We are tilting towards knowing what is causing dryness in the land. This is famine. Nothing is working. Okay, next. He said, the vine is dried up and the fig tree languishes. The pomegranate tree, the palm tree also, and the apple tree, everything is affected. Next. Guard yourself and lament, ye priest. How, ye ministers of the altar. He said, come. Please go back, I'm not done with the previous. He said, lie all night in sackcloth, ye ministers of my God, for the meat offering and the drink offering is hidden, is withholden from the house of God. They said this problem was not just a problem in the society alone, that it has also affected the church. And so every minister should go down on their knees with fasting for what? Restoration. Restoration from what? He says, sanctify ye a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land into the house of the Lord your God, and cry unto the Lord. Next. Alas, for the day of the Lord is at hand, and as a destruction from the mighty. Please go back. Is that from the Almighty shall it come? Okay, now the next. Please, can we all be up, Andrew? This is where the problem is. What caused the plague? and I read. He said, "Is not this, is not the meat cut off because our eyes, before our eyes, yea, joy and gladness from the house." That is the problem. It's a joy and gladness is out of place. He said, when this thing is not in place, what happens? You will look at your life and think you sinned. Let's be seated. Have you been privileged to talk to people and from the sincerity of their hearts, they look at you and say, I don't know where I have sinned. I don't know what I have done. I don't know where this affliction is coming from. I thought I have kept all the laws that I should keep. I submit to you that that is not enough. If joy is out of place, your life can never be stable. Everything we've been reading, that which the Bama was have eaten, that which the Gaga was the caterpillar, and everything, he said, is as a result of joy not being present in the house of God. So as believers, once joy is withdrawn, affliction steps in. All manner of things are in place in your life because joy is out of place. Hear me. Strength, as Jesus told us, is not a product of perfection per se. The strength is a product of joy. And so in the book of Nehemiah chapter 8 verse 10, it says, for the joy of the Lord will strengthen you. And by the time you are strengthened, even in the face of challenges and vicissitudes, God is saying your life will be rearranged. This decadence and the abomination we saw here, that evil crept into the church, from the society into the church, he said it cannot stand. How serious is this matter of joy? Please project for us Romans chapter 14 verse 17. Romans chapter 14 verse 17, it says, for the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace. And what? You see that the kingdom of God, which is the things that characterizes the Christian experience as a believer, there are three pillars that holds us in the faith. Number one, righteousness. Two, God. Is there such a thing as righteousness in the Holy Ghost? Have you heard it? Have you heard it? Can you give a scripture to prove that? That there's such a thing called righteousness in the Holy Ghost. Have you heard it? It is joy in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. That is where strength is hidden. Look, let me tell you, we are in a day and age where as believers we can pray for as long as we like. It will not stop challenges. Hear me. You know why? Most of these things happening to us, they are a plot to distracting us from what truly matters. So most times we go to the place of prayers. You know why? Because we have a challenge, not because we have a relationship with God. Prayers truly is not a matter of deliverance, it's first a matter of fellowship and intimacy. So I was speaking to somebody maybe because I said, we know this song. There is something that, sorry, quiet, no verse. I'm not trying to castigate songs for you. You know, there is something that makes me come into your presence, my helper. You already know that as it's coming, God is helper. And there is something that makes me come into your presence, is selfishness. He said there is something which is not me, and they look for something. It is something. He's got something. I'm not looking for God. That's what the song is saying. Something. There is something that makes me come into your presence. The first question is, where did you even see his presence? Your motive has defied the whole system to start with. He said, there is something that makes me run into your presence. Then he said, you are my helper. And you think such things move God? It doesn't. So the first thing you should reckon with about prayers is intimacy. And I was speaking with this person, I told him, I said, this can be hitting me from left, right, and center. I don't have a car yet. I don't have a job. I am owing credits everywhere. My business is not moving. Hello, church. It is not time to wake up at midnight to fire prayer because you have a problem. It is not a principle. I have not seen that in my Bible. Let me tell you, take everything away because they are distractions. A songwriter said, give me you, everything else can wait. He said, all I need is Jesus, everything should wait. But when I apprehend him, or when he apprehends me, he said, every other thing will come. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Every other thing will be what? Added. That law has not changed. There is something that makes me run into his presence, my helper. What is that thing? Say our dad is, you will never pray until your child is sick. Our young sisters, it is not time to wake up. One of our brothers, my friend, was speaking. He said, let's begin. You know, it was when we were talking about family. As young people, what book have you read about marriage? What book have you read about family life? You are dull on all sides, yet you have first class in university. And you think your first class will save you in marriage? No, 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 one said there are first class graduates who are, in fact, they didn't even get a pass in marriage. What is the message this morning? There is a secret to joy. What is joy we are talking about? He said it is the strength of the Lord. What does it mean? In the face of challenges, I know these are arrows fired at me to distract me from my Creator, from fellowshipping, and then your problems becomes your God, because that is where your attention is. Why not look away from those vicissitudes of life and turn to your Maker? I said, Lord, I know that these problems actually exist. He said, but I am not here to talk about them. Lord, what would you have me do for you? Yet these mighty people are not people without problems. They only know how to embarrass and disgrace their problems. Great people, they are not people that lack problems truly, but they are people that knows how to embarrass their problems. And then at the end of the day, problem comes here and say, and they push you, and they push you, you know they respond. He turns back and walks away. He don't pray about it. But when I look at the problem, the reason why I wake up at midnight and, like we say, fire prayer, is because there's a problem. Whereas you don't even have an idea, a revelational inclination of who you are calling. And so over time, I have sustained the mentality that problems can be here, there, and there. But once I keep my gaze on Christ, looking unto him, the author and the finisher of my faith, everything is taken care of. And that principle has never failed. And you know what? Any man that understands this principle, somebody who has sustained the mystery of joy. And you know what? There is great relationship between faith and joy. Hear this. Faith and sorrow do not live together. Are you with me? Faith and sorrow, they are not friends. And you know that sorrow begets worry, or worry begets sorrow, right? They are interwoven. So we preach against worry, and then we speak for faith, isn't it? Now, anybody that has faith understands joy. And so look at our hymn this morning. I brought my bulletin. The third stanza here says, the second line, it says, faith can sing through days of sorrow. What do you think the song of faith is in the days of sorrow? It's a song of joy. So the message is simple. Look away from your challenges and say, Lord, I know these things, they exist, but I have not come to you to discuss about my problems. I have come to fellowship. I've just come here to make sounds. I've just come to speak to you. Do you know how to talk? Do you know how to sing? Or you just stay there and begin to pray in tongues, enjoying yourself under that anointing. And then the Lord is saying, I know you have this problem. I know police is looking for you. I know what is going on in your family. I know you don't even know what or have not to eat tomorrow. But here you are ministering to me. And then the Lord arises from his throne and says, whatever this man needs, I provide them now. And you begin to have supernatural encounters. Psalms chapter 51. Let's read from verse 6. Psalms 51 from verse 6. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward part, and in the hidden part thou had made me know wisdom. Okay, let's go. Wash me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter. Okay, next. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. He said, help me. What I want to hear is joy. You know what? It's like when you put your earpod or earpiece, alright, in your ears, what anybody is saying in your environment, you don't hear them, right? He said, when you have blocked your ears with joy, you will not hear sorrow. So it is a conscious decision everyone in this household of faith should take. I say, Lord, I cover my ears with joy, so I will not hear sorrow from today. Let's look at the next. What's the next? Verse 9. He said, hide thy face from my sin and blot out all my iniquities. Verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Verse 11. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. The next, which is my emphasis, he said, restore unto me what joy. You see, salvation is a package. It's like a truck that houses a lot of things that will sustain you throughout your life on earth. And so when you notice that at a point there's a decline and reduction of joy, it's a call for restoration. So Samuel saw that something was wrong and he called on the Lord. Mind you, if you check Psalm 122, don't go there. Psalm chapter 122, verse 1. He was he that said, I was glad when they said, let's go into the house of the Lord. You see, I have a problem with that scripture. I'm still trying to find out what happened or if it was a grammatical error. He said, I was glad. It's not like I am glad. And then today we were singing and we changed it. Why did you not sing? I was glad I belongs to Jesus. What does it mean? It means there was a time I was glad. Now, what is the problem? So he said, I was glad when they said, let us go to the house of the Lord. Do you know that even in the church today, there are many people sitting here that do not have, they do not deprive the joy in coming to church. Challenges have hit you from everywhere. Somebody said something in church and you don't want to worship there again. My friend, did you go to church because you have your neighbor? Was your neighbor a motivational factor for going to church? If we understand that we came to church to meet Jehovah and not any man, whatever they say, they should go and die. You know, Christianity is personal. I can't break my head for your stupidity. It's a secret of sustaining this church we are talking about. And so the psalmist said, I was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord. Sir, what happened to you? Why was it was and not I am? So you believe now that my introduction was right, that something, there's something that can be missing from your life, that when things start hitting from everywhere, you will think that it was sin that caused it. But here we have found out that joy is a pillar, one of the three pillars sustaining the kingdom. He said, for the kingdom of God is what? It's about these three: righteousness, peace, and joy. What? Now let's look at Hebrews as a roundup. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 9. Look at it. He said, thou hast loved righteousness, and you have hated iniquity. He said, therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of what? Above what? So you see another relationship again between righteousness and what? Joy. Are you with me now? So as you progress, the beginning point is to love righteousness. How to attain this life of joy we are talking about? It begins with righteousness. He said then the end point. So he didn't mention joy in between again now. Any peace. But on that path, what you take along with you into peace, into joy, is peace. He said, because you have loved righteousness and have hated iniquity, he said, therefore God, that God has anointed you, so one can be anointed with joy. He said, joy is an anointing. You know, we anoint people. People can be anointed for healing, for the prophetic, for all of this, but nobody ever taught us that joy is an anointing. So nobody just wakes up one day and begin to enjoy, you know, joy. He said, joy is an anointing. And so one of the prayers we're going to pray this morning is, Lord, anoint me afresh with joy. Look at what happened to the disciples before they became apostles. In the book of Mark, chapter 4, from verse 36. Please don't go there. Let me just tell the story. We're told that they were in a boat with Jesus and they were headed somewhere. Jesus was somewhere sleeping, and then all of a sudden the Bible said that there was a great tempest and there was this trouble and fighting in the sea, and then they were all perplexed. They ran to meet Jesus and said, Master, Master, carest not that we perish? Hear me, that turbulence that took place, if you have eyes as you read through scriptures, there's a way you visualize what is happening. I've not been in sea before, but there was an explanation that Bob was giving or somebody, that there is a ship that is as big as Omoko in a sea, yet that ship can capsize. Are you with me? Let alone the boat that Jesus was in with his disciples, yet in the heart, there was something he had that these guys didn't have that made him sleep under such tension. And then they ran to meet him and said, Master, so you don't care about us that we are perishing? And then when he got up, because he has the anointing in full measure, scripture spoke about him in the book of Hebrews chapter 10, verse 11. He said, how God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about, the first thing he did was not to heal, was to do good. So one of the good he did was to save the disciples on that day. The first thing was not to heal you, was not to give you prophecy, it was to do you good. So he got up and spoke to the wind, to the storm, and the Bible said, what? It ceased. Hallelujah. Please, let's be on our feet this morning. There's one thing I want us to do. I want you to look at that challenge in the eyes. Mention it. Say, I know you are here. which I stand. Open your mouth and pray. There's no better way to say it to energize you and to ginger you to pray. Have you started a project? Hear me, I know how these things work. You have started a project with a particular energy, and then at the end of the day, it's as if things are not going in the direction wherein you have planned. Hear me, the Lord is saying, if you look away from your lack, He said, I will feed you beyond measure. I don't know what is happening to my business. I don't know what is happening to my marriage. I've been seeking for help. I've been meeting anointed counselors to help me. Yet the help is not coming forth. He said, Lord, I have come to this place tonight. Because Bible said, upon Mount Zion there shall be deliverance. And you have come to Zion this morning. And you say, Lord, I lay them at your feet. Anoint me with joy. Anoint me with the oil of gladness.
Just one encounter with you has turned my whole life around. Has turned my whole life around. Just one encounter with you has turned my whole life around.
The Lord encounter me tonight and turn my story around. When He visits, the first thing He's going to do, He will restore the joy of fellowship and not the joy of request. It is the joy of fellowship that He will restore, and then every other thing, you will see them moving in your direction, that you will grow up to an extent that the things you don't even request for, they'll be waiting for you, they'll be looking for you, contract will be looking for you, appointment will be pursuing you, because you found a key called joy. Things you did not love before, God brings them to you. Calls begin to come and say, we have been looking for you all this while. Because a man decided to shift his focus from mundane things. I know you have been praying. I know you've been waking up at midnight. I know you've been weeping over that challenge. But the Lord is saying to you, if only you can talk to me, He said, I will fill you first with joy. He will anoint you with joy, and every other thing will settle. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. Because this day was divinely orchestrated by you. And it has pleased you that you shouldn't understand the power of joy. From today, sadness had no place in your life. Sorrow has no hold in your life. Pain has no hold in your life. Everything in your life characterizing destruction, they shift from you now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Please stand in the moment. Can we stretch out our hand to the vessel that God has used for us this morning? And let us pray for him.